Hello everyone, welcome back with the next session of Reproduction in Organisms, Standard 12, Chapter 1. You remember that, right? So we are discussing about the reproduction in organisms, and we are actually going to study about the basically the asexual reproduction right now. And I have discussed about what is fission, what is binary fission, and what is multiple fission. So basically, what is asexual mode of reproduction? It is a mode of reproduction where only single parent is required and there is no variation that is seen. That's okay, fine. But sometimes this asexual reproduction is also very important. Why? Because during asexual reproduction, we get a clone. What is the meaning of a clone? We get an exact copy of the parent organism. So whatever the characteristics are there present in the parent, it will be moving to the offspring. So sometimes that is helpful, sometimes it is very beneficial. So when we are talking about asexual mode of reproduction, there are different types of reproduction. There is fission, there is multiple fission is there, then there is a binary fission, then we have other mode like fragmentation, sporulation, and so on. So we'll be discussing one by one each of it. We finish with the fission. Let us see what we have as next. Next mode of asexual reproduction is budding. Now, budding word itself contains the term bud, right? So this type of asexual mode of reproduction is seen in some unicellular organisms. What is the meaning of unicellular? Uni means single. So all the single-celled organisms will be showing this mode of reproduction that is called as budding. Not all, some of them will be showing it, okay? And some multicellular organisms also, they will be showing this type of reproduction method. So what happens in budding? Budding is a process where there will be a bud. There will be a, like how we get a bud in the flower, before the flower blooms, we get a bud, and then the bud blooms to be a flower. Similarly, in case of budding, during reproduction, in asexual reproduction, there will be a bud formation, and that bud will grow to a new organism. And that process is divided into two ways. One is called as external budding and the other one is called as internal budding. So what is the meaning of external budding? External means this way there will be the bud is formed outside the body of the organisms. Internal budding on the other hand, where the organisms will have the buds inside their body. Got it, right? It's easy to understand, isn't it? The external one, the bud is formed outside the body of the organism. Internal, the bud is formed internally. Okay, let us understand different types of budding. Let us know it in detail about what is external budding and what is internal budding in the next few slides. So, okay, here I have the external budding as the first one. What is external budding? It is also called as exogenous bud. What it is called as? Exogenous bud. That means the bud which is formed outside the body of the organism. That is exogenous bud. Basically, it is seen in case of yeast. What happens in yeast? I hope you have all know what is a yeast. The baker's yeast, right? The normal one what we use it. That is yeast. It's a very common organism, which is a very useful microorganism also, right? So yeast reproduces by budding. What happens in yeast? During the reproductive stage of yeast, when the yeast becomes mature, it will form an external bud. How does the external bud is getting formed? As you can see over here, there is a nucleus and there is a vacuole. Now, when the reproduction needs to happen, at that time, there will be a bud formation. This is a bud formation stage where there will be an external bud that will form. The nucleus will extend and it will go to the bud portion also. And that will detach from the body of the yeast and then the new organism will form. So the nucleus divides into two, and once the nucleus is divided, this bud, when it grows to a proper size and shape, they will get detached from the body of the yeast and can form a new yeast. So from the parent yeast, we get a daughter yeast. And it is not that one yeast is forming only one bud itself. They can form several buds also. So as you can see in this photo, there is two buds which is getting formed, and both of these will get mature and these will be separated out from the body of the yeast. Did you understand? So what is happening in exogenous bud formation? Exogenous bud means when the bud is forming outside the body of the organism as an attachment. That is called as exogenous budding.
Okay.
But also is seen in Hydra. I have given you the example of yeast. Similarly, in Hydra also we can see the example of budding. Okay, internal budding. Internal budding is called as endogenous bud. Exo is external, endo is internal, right? This is easy to understand. In this case, we call it as gemmule formation. What is it? It is called as gemmule formation. So many times in the competitive exam, they have asked, what is gemmule? Okay, so you should remember, gemmule is nothing but it is an endogenous or internal bud formation. Got it, right? So gemmule is a type of gemmules are those which forms inside a pitcher, or it's like a pot type of appearance. Okay, inside that particular organism, when they wanted to divide, there will be small tiny cells which are called as archinocytes. Here you can see this. These cells are called as archaeocytes. They are provided with a coating. That coating is called as spicules. What is it called as? Called as spicules. So gemmule consists of cells called as archaeocytes, enclosed by a protective coat of spicules. So gemmule, let us see the diagram, it will be more easy to understand. Yeah, this is the spicule. Can you see now? See here, these are the spicules which is protecting. It is a protective coat. What is a spicule? Spicule is a protective coat. Where do we see this? We see this inside the gemmule. This is a whole gemmule. This whole thing is a gemmule. And what is present inside the gemmule? Inside the gemmule, we have these archaeocytes. So these tiny or bubbles type of appearance, whatever you are seeing it, these are nothing but the archaeocytes. Did you get it? Okay. So now how these are going to come out? How these things are going to come out from the body of the organism? It will be coming out by the small opening. That opening is called as micropyle. What is that opening called as? It is called as micropyle. So internal budding or endogenous budding is, well, there will be a gemmule which will be containing lot of tiny cells. Those are called as archaeocytes, right? And they are covered with a protective coat. That coat is called as spicules, okay? During the favorable condition, when the favorable condition appears for that organism, archaeocytes come out of the micropyle. They will come out of this micropyle to form new colonies. So there will be tiny these archaeocytes which come out, and they will be forming a new colony after that, okay? So this is called as internal budding, or this is the endogenous budding. Okay, next we have sporulation. Now we have discussed about fission, and I also discussed about budding. Try to remember the examples in each cases, okay? So next mode of asexual reproduction is called as sporulation. Sporulation, spore formation, that's it, right? Spores are small, microscopic, unicellular structures. What are spores? Spores are small, microscopic, unicellular structure that contain a nucleus that is surrounded by a cytoplasm, and they are capable of forming new individuals, and when there is a favorable condition. Now this spore formation is not only seen in lower category of plants, but it is also seen in some higher plants also. So spore formation is nothing like, okay, whenever there is an unfavorable condition, when the conditions are not good, when the hard situation arises, the organism start to form spores. Now spores are like, they're taking the information, the plant's body's information or the organism's information is stored in the form of spore. Whenever there is a favorable condition, that spore will germinate and they will form a new organism. Okay, so spores are small, microscopic, unicellular. Remember these words, they are small, very small they will be, microscopic. We cannot see through them by our naked eyes. They are unicellular, means they are having only single cell, and they contain a nucleus surrounded by a cytoplasm. So there will be a nucleus, prominent nucleus. If you draw a spore properly, you can see that there is a prominent nucleus present on them, and there contains a lot of cytoplasmic material which is present around it. So there is a nucleus and a cytoplasm, and they are capable of forming a new individual. Whenever that it's required during the favorable condition, this one spore itself can form a new organism. Understood? So that process is called as sporulation. Now there are two types of sporulation. Let us see what are the sporulations are all about. Spore formation is basically seen in most commonly in algae and fungi. And the most commonly produced spores are zoospores and conidia. What are the two type of spores? The first one is zoospore and the second one is called as conidia. Okay, now what is this zoospore and what is this conidia? Let us learn about it. Zoospores are spores, that is, zoospores are unicellular microscopic motile structure. Remember this word, motile. What is the meaning of motile? Means they can move, or if they require, they can swim around. Okay, so these are unicellular, having single cell, microscopic, very tiny, we can't see through our naked eyes, we need microscope for that. They are motile, they can move, like they know they can't walk, but because they have the flagella type of appearances, they can move or they can swim in the environment. And they produce a special bodies called as, they are produced in a special bodies called as sporangia. So the spore forming organ is called as sporangia. What is sporangia? Sporangia is nothing but spore forming organ of the organism, that is called as sporangia. And here is the example of Chlamydomonas. As you can see here, in there is a sporangia. Sporangia means the particular pouch or the place where the spores are getting formed. In that, the spores will form, and during the condition, in the unfavorable conditions are there, the spore will form. Whenever there is a favorable condition, they will burst out open and they will go and scatter everywhere, and these zoospores will be forming one new organism. Is it clear to you? Do you understand what is sporulation? Sporulation is formation of spore. Well, which organism shows this? This is seen in algae and funguses. So algae and fungi, these organisms are reproducing asexually by spore formation. There's two type of spores are there, zoospores and conidia. I have just now spoken about zoospore. Let us see what is conidia is all about. Okay. Here it is. Conidia are usually microscopic. Obviously, as I told you, spores are microscopic. So these are also microscopic, uninucleate or multinucleate. So conidia can have one nucleus, or conidia can also have multiple nucleus, more than one nucleus also may be present if it is required. Okay, and they can germinate and grow to a new organism. Each conidium can germinate and form a new organism, what we see in Penicillium. Okay, so what happens, these on the top, can you see these tiny structures over here? Okay, let me change the color of the pen. Can you see these structures over here? These are like spore-like appearance, right? As if they are continuous spore-like structures appearance present in that particular stem of that Penicillium growth, the fungus. Okay, so these are actually nothing but the conidia. Each conidium, now conidium is singular, conidia is plural. Conidium, one of the conidium, that any one of it can form a new organism. That is what is the speciality of conidia. So conidia is microscopic, uninucleate. Either they have one nucleus or they have more than one nucleus, and they can germinate to a new organism. Penicillium notatum, the fungus, is reproducing by this method. Okay. Now after the sporulation, next one is called as fragmentation. Fragmentation, what is the meaning? See, you know, in biology, one very nice thing is, if you understand the meaning of that particular word, then you can actually guess what it would be, and you can actually write down some points on that. Fragmentation means forming fragments, right? That's it. So fragmentation is a process where the organism get detached into different fragments, and that fragments give birth to a new individual. That is called as fragmentation. So it is generally seen in case of filamentous algae. They are like a filament, they're like a long strips. So these long strips, like a ribbon type of strips will be there, right? So these strips, when they break open, they're like a fragment, and then they will be forming this new individual. And that process is called as fragmentation. Okay. Example is in Spirogyra and in Nostoc. Okay.